All right, shalom, shalom, everyone. Welcome
back. Shalom.
I am still Moreh Chizakyah. I'll be doing the culture portion for this day. And of course, you know, I'm just saying this for everybody that doesn't know me that's watching this live stream. So I'm going to start off with a canvassing question. Everyone sitting in the room, at home, how many of us came to this culture? And I've asked this before in the past. I'm going to go revisit some things that I've asked before. And all these things that I'm getting into is based on my experiences these past 2 weeks. So how many of us in here has come to this way outside of being a Christian? Outside of believing in Jesus? You've come to know that you're a Hebrew Israelite, but before that, you didn't know anything about Jesus. So everyone in here, it's safe to say that everyone in here, including myself, knew Jesus or the concept of Jesus before you knew yourself to be a Hebrew.
Okay.
So, by stating that, and we also know that, you know, you have been influenced, whether you are in the paradigm of Christianity or not, by Christianity in the United States of America.
Okay.
You have been influenced, either directly or indirectly. So, by say, yes. Excuse me. Remind me. Kind of threw me off.
In this country.
Right, indirectly in this country. But it was a point I was getting to. That's why I got to stay. Boom. All right, let me just get to the point. So when you came into this way, for the most of us we come to know the culture, we're not empty, including myself, including all the Moreh that I've met. We come in, we're still half full with what we know, and then we kind of backpedal and try to learn the culture, the traditions, and what do these really mean, how these are practical applications.
Okay.
My new saying is this, or it's been old, but I'm articulating it to you this way. What is a religion? A religion is, and the best way I would, you know, get you to relate to anyone else that asks you what's the difference between religion and your culture, is that a culture has rituals that go with that culture. Everybody following me? These rituals have an origin of where they came from, which pertains to your family. You know, my granddaddy, he used to go to the beach every Sunday and bathe in the water. That was his ritual. So now it's been passed on from generation to generation that our male family members go to the beach and bathe from generation to generation. That's an example. And it may be a detailed reason why that was done that maybe only the family knows, right? And we may write it in a book.
Mm-hmm.
What happens is when someone else comes and sees these rituals and finds something that they like about it, whatever the case may be, and they say, okay, I see these people, whoever these people are, doing this, but that right there is nice. So I'm going to take these rituals and I'm going to do them.
Mm. Come on.
So now what happens is this person is doing these rituals without true understanding of what they're doing.
Okay.
They're formulating their own beliefs, their own thoughts of what the origin of these practices are. You understand? And that becomes their religion. So they've negated the origins or the true culture and the true understandings behind what's being done, and they're practicing something that becomes their religion. So with the absence of the culture, the understanding of the wise from being taught by the people that actually did it, it leaves room for these new interpolators, people that come in to add their own dogmatic reasons for why they're doing or practicing their religion. All right? Anybody have any questions about that? Everybody understand what I just said? Did it go over anybody's head? It could be wicked, but it's no different than, man, I really like that. You know, I just go to India. We call it today. If you guys turn on your TV today and we just experience watching commercials because we don't have TV, So we just watched 2 weeks worth of commercials, and Maisha, she like she had a hand up. She wanted to say something.
No, I was talking about the movie you watched. Remember you woke up and you were in the hotel, you were like, what are you watching? And I was talking about how the young man was teaching his sister to do yoga.
Uh-huh.
And he was like, okay, first you do this, you put your hands to your chest, you say namaste. She said, why do you say namaste? He was like, nobody really knows what you mean, you should just say it.
Right. That's a good example. That's a perfect example. And what's happening, we live in a society that's built on culture piracy.
Okay.
Cultural piracy. Mm-hmm. So going back to the commercial, you turn on the TV, you see your hair rap music, your hair hip hop, but you don't see you. You see a new group of people that's practicing the things that you know, if you know history or you came up in those days, that was started by you. And it may be one of you to appease you or two of you in the commercial or so on and so forth. But you like they pop locking, they break dancing or whatever, but you're not in it. It's like, what? Something's off with this, you know, in my mind. So you have people, they go to India, they come back to America. Hey, brother, peace, brother. Namaste. They don't know what they're doing, but they feel, man, it's those people look peaceful. So I'm going to take this, and I'm going to come back, and my brother, you need to know, I'm a Buddhist now. I got my beads, I got my namaste, man. But they don't know why they're saying that. They don't know what they're doing. They don't know the true meaning of what Buddhism is because it's cultural.
Mm-hmm. Right. And just to make it, like, bring it home, I lived in New York for 2 years. I lived in Long Island. And some people would say that's not New York, but that was New York to me, baby. That was it. It was like the hood. It was crazy. But after 2 years, we moved back down south. We moved to Alabama, right? And when I came back to Alabama, I'm like 15. So I'm rocking uptowns, you know, they call them Air Force Ones or whatever. I'm rocking like what they, you know, wear in New York. I'm talking like a New Yorker with a Southern accent, though, but still using New York slang and terminology. So it was like, what I did, I took their culture to a certain extent, which I didn't fully understand. I only had 2 years there, but I had enough to adapt and make it look like. So when I went back down south, it was like, yeah, where this guy from? He's wearing these shoes. You know, at the time when I was in the South, we were wearing Reebok Classics and stuff like that. You know, so you know, like, we were wearing Saconis. That stuff. Yeah, Saconis and, you know, feelers and things of that nature. But they was wearing certain shoes. So I was doing their culture with a Southern spin. So it's just an example of how you take something from somewhere, you may or may not fully understand why they dress, why they're so into fashion, and why they're so into things. But then you take it back somewhere where they're not, and then it's like you create a hybrid of that. You see what I'm saying? So I was popular because it was like I was different down there. You know what I'm saying? So people wanted to find out where I got certain things from. So just giving an example of taking a culture from another area, bring it in the United States, and then bring it to another state where it's totally different, and then just kind of like a hybrid. It creates a hybrid. Really.
Okay, absolutely. Hybridization. All right. So I'm going to ask you all to do something with me. Since we all know that we come and learn that, oh man, Deuteronomy 28, I'm a Hebrew. Yay. All right. I got to be Hebrew, whatever that means. I need you guys to do something for me. Every belief, just for today, it's going to be hard for some of you. You're going to fight against this, and I'm going to try to show you how to look at things objectively. Not what you believe, but objectively. So I'm going to ask you to throw out whatever you believe out the door for today. Only thing I ask you to know is you're Hebrew, right? You're Hebrew Israelite. That's all I need to be in your head. I'm a Hebrew Israelite. I come to know I'm a Hebrew Israelite. But I don't know anything else. Nothing else. Everybody following me? You may have some understanding of Torah, but you don't know anything else. Or Tanakh, you don't know anything else. All right? So, what we're going to go over today, if I sound like I'm yelling, I'm projecting so that they can hear me because I don't want to walk around with a microphone in my hand. We're going to talk about, I have cognition, but we're going to actually be talking about cognitive dissonance. We're going to talk about, if we have time, if time permits, we'll try to hit these wickets. But if not, don't worry about it. We'll revisit it later on at another time. Circular reasoning, proof texting, And we're going to get into what a set theory is. Okay? Now, how did this come about? I've been studying, looking for certain things, understanding. I have experienced cognitive dissonance. And I think everybody's experienced. I'm going to explain what it is in a second. And I didn't know what the word was. I didn't understand what it was, but I knew what I felt. So, cognitive or cognition is beliefs, ideas, or opinions. Cognition, your belief, idea, or opinion. Belief, idea, or opinions. Dissonance, if you want to just put, it's disharmony.
Disharmony?
Disharmony. If you want to get a little bit longer understand, it's a clash resulting from the combination of two disharmonious or unsuitable elements. It's a clash in your mind. It's a clash in your belief. It's a clash in what you want to believe. It ain't going with the flow. My mind was at ease. This brother came and threw something in there. All right, and I'm going to explain something. Now, I'm not taking the credit for what I'm saying to you because I watch different videos, I watch rabbis talk, I watch different people talk. But what I got from it is what I know I've experienced. All right? Yeah, okay. All right. The theory of cognitive dissonance is quickly summarized, but it has a wide scope. It could be different things. The theory states that whenever an individual holds two cognitions or two beliefs, ideas, or opinions, which are psychologically inconsistent, he or she will experience a drive to reduce this inconsistency. Does everybody understand what I'm saying? If you have a belief, you hold two cognitions, two beliefs, or two ideas, or two opinions, right? And it's psychologically inconsistent. It doesn't add up to logic. It doesn't add up to logic. Your mind gets a disharmony or dissonance, meaning you know 1 + 1 = 2, but somebody keeps telling you it equals 3. You're like, what? No, I know 1 + 1 = 2. Why do you keep saying 3? I don't get it. Right? So you're off. It's throwing your mind off. I witnessed this weekend. Yes.
If I can, it's a lack of agreement between reality and a false conceptualization of what you're seeing. It doesn't agree. So what's?
Okay.
No. So everybody follow. When he says dissonance, there's a lack of agreement. So anytime the opposite of that is, I can see that 1 + 1 = 2. So my eyes agree with that, right? My brain agrees with that. But if somebody puts 3 up there, even though my eyes might see that, my brain is not, there's no agreement with that. So, it's like a computer glitch.
Right.
Or a computer malfunction. Like, right, trying to run Apple software on a PC.
Throw something in there just to see. From my understanding, it also can mean you have two spheres or two sides to your brain.
Right.
So you have one that clings more toward, tends more to your artistic or spiritual side, then you have one that tends more towards your logical side. So what happens is that your logical side says this, but your spiritual realm says something else, and it can create it's just like having faith, right? Somebody says they're gonna do something, and you can't see it. You can't see it. So logically, you're having an argument in your brain now, logically. But just saying logically, I can't see that happening. But the other side of your brain is saying, well, so I just want to throw that in there too, to not say that it is a bad thing. You know what I'm saying? I'm not saying y'all are, but I don't want people to think that, Oh, that's bad. That's bad then. No, that is a natural occurrence inside of your mind. Flesh and blood, spirit and flesh. You know, you hear it throughout our text. You know what I'm saying? So I just want to bring that out too.
It's like two things, both of them right. You got this way is right and this way is right. When you put them together, it's like playing a D and an E and then a harmonize. The notes come up solid and sounds bad.
I'm not working on music, so.
Okay. If you try to work it either way, or you try to work them together, it don't work. Mm-hmm. If you try to work them apart and separate, one might work better than the other, but they both work.
Or you can take two great singers, both they're excellent, mm-hmm. and you can put them together, and they cannot sound good together.
Okay, that actually goes with music. I mean, it's actually a definition to what this is in music, harmonious flow of music. Or going back to what Adone said, if somebody tells you they're going to do something, and you don't see it. But it's more to it than that. It's more to it than that. But I'm 100% what he's saying. It deals with both sides of your brain. Right? But dissonance may be reduced by changing either or both of the existing cognitions, or by adding new opinions which reduce the conflict by putting it in a new perspective. So what the mind does, it's like you said, a person's supposed to help me do something, right? They said they're gonna be here Tuesday, 5:00, never showed up. Right? So you're like, dang, I was depending on him. He said he was gonna be there, so on and so forth. So when you get in contact with the person, they're like, well, I showed up. You ain't see me with everybody else? And you're like, no, I showed up. You know? And I'm just using this as an example. You will find a reason. You didn't see them. Everybody else didn't see them. But you will find a reason to make it so that they were probably there. Or maybe they came and they did a couple things and they left or whatever. You start making something in your mind to make it flow positive because you don't want to lose faith or trust in that person. You understand what I'm saying? And I wish I had my Willie Lynch letter in there because when it hit me this weekend, it's in there. It doesn't say it in those words, but it's in the Willie Lynch letter. So, it's important to note that according to the dissonance theory, when a person is led to modify dissonant cognitions, he is concerned to reduce his psychological discomfort rather than to bring his cognition into line with reality. So, you're just trying to make yourself feel comfortable in whatever your thoughts, belief, or whatever it is, but you're not bringing it in line with reality. That's not your objective. Your objective is to some way keep believing what you believe or trusting in what you trust in, who, she, it, whatever the case may be, but you're not lining it up with what's evident.
So pretty much it's like making up an excuse to believe what you did not see.
You're making up your own reality.
Like,
yes.
Your own reasoning in your brain
right.
What just happened.
Right.
Or what did not happen.
Right.
Okay.
Even though you and everybody else see this is what it is, but the end result is not, what you're coming up with does not align up with what you're saying. It happens with a lot of cults, like, not taking a stab or anything like that. Malachi York, you know, he came years ago, he pretty much every different belief system, he put it together in his faith or whatever the case may be, he had hundreds, maybe thousands of followers. And pretty much in a year, he got locked up. He pretty much got thrown into prison, right?
Okay.
So the dissidents, the cognition is, oh, he's our savior. We're going to go to his camp. We're going to be with him. He's the savior. He's our savior. Look at all the stuff that he knows. But your savior got put in jail. That's the reality. The dissidents is like, well, he's the savior. How did the savior get put in jail?
He's a god.
Say again?
Or he's a god.
Or he's a god.
God is in jail now.
And God is in jail now. So how does my mind reconcile my belief? I've given up my life for this belief. People see me. People see me on the street saying whatever.
So now I have to, my mind is working to make that make sense to me. And that's what the dissonance is. Oh man, that wasn't him. That was a lifeless dummy that they took to jail, and he went ascended back to the planet Risk where he came from and waiting to return. This is real stuff. I'm not making this up.
Yeah.
That's the dissonance. And he still has followers. And in some cases they get even more fervent, meaning they get even more rejuvenated to get more people to believe what they believe to keep the cycle going. Cognitive dissonance. Somebody had their hand up before that? Go ahead.
So going back to you saying empty ourselves, let's just think Hebrew, right?
Right.
So I like the idea of the left side, right side. Mm-hmm. But now I'm thinking like left side, right side. The two thoughts was North Kingdom and the South Kingdom. And then the Northern Kingdom had a false belief of, oh, if we just build this stuff, it's going to make us feel good.
Mm-hmm.
But in reality, it's not. Reality, and through outside, everybody sees, oh, I wonder what their Elohim is saying about them. You know what I mean? But the Southern Kingdom is more like, they were more down, they were more like, they knew what was going on, and they continued to stay steadfast. So it's like the dissonance with the Northern Kingdom is more like, what they built, their altars, was their God. And then the cognition was, if I continue to worship it, this is my reality.
I follow you. Can I say it a different way? All of Israel know by Torah where they're supposed to worship. Northern Kingdom, Southern Kingdom. It's in Jerusalem, right?
Okay.
At the temple, right?
Okay.
The Northern Kingdom had someone convince them, built a temple in Samaria, and said, this is where we worship now.
Mm.
So I wasn't there. But let's say I was. I'll be like, well, I know Torah says we're supposed to go to the place that Yahweh told us to go. I mean, we're supposed to go to Jerusalem down south. Why are we doing this? And then they may come up with a reason, reasoning in the mind. Oh, because we can't really go down there because, you know, it's not written anywhere, but it says, well, it does say in a place where he calls his name. So he must have told the king that this is what he wants us to do it. So they rationalize it to make it comfortable in their minds to go to the Northern Kingdom or to Samaria to worship. It's coming with a rationalization in the mind to make everything flow in your brain. Everybody following? All right. So it's important to note that according to dissonance theory, when a person is led to modify dissonant cognitions, he is concerned to reduce his psychological discomfort rather than to bring his cognition into line with reality. The theory does not rest upon the assumption that man is a rational animal. Rather, it suggests that man is a rationalizing animal, that he attempts to appear rational both to others and to himself or herself. So what happens is a lot of times, you know, someone may ask a question and the response is kind of like left field, and you're sitting there like, hey, maybe you may make it make sense to yourself, and you go, like, yeah, I guess that makes sense. Yeah, okay, whatever. Yeah, that makes sense. I was looking up the thing. Can you find me when it talks about creating illusions, and then after a while, the cycle of illusions will keep spinning on their own. Because when a fact is presented, the dissonance is always going to make that person change, shift, to make it be harmonious with their mind. All right? So I'm going to give you examples later. We're going to talk about circular reasoning. Okay? And I experienced this weekend when I was going into scriptures. And, of course, the whole concept was about Jesus. And it's like, okay, the scripture says, how do you explain this? And it always goes back to Jesus. No proof, no anything, it just goes back to Jesus. I have proof, and they proof text. So you have circular reasoning, with proof text. And proof text is in the point of, I ask you a question first. A canvas question is, you believe in Yeshua or Jesus before you came into this walk, right? So you already believe, right? Nobody in here came to learn about the Most High and then find Yeshua. Nobody that I talked to. Even my grandma, I got some good history with my grandmother. She gave me some history, and it kind of blew my mind. And what happens is missionaries will say, you can't, with empirical proof, find Jesus in the Old Testament. You can't. And I'm going to explain that in a second. You can't. I mean, somebody could say they could find it. Somebody could say this is what this is, and that's what that is, and we're going to get to that. You can't. But what happens is, if you already believe on this person, everything else, when you look back, you're going to see him everywhere. Everywhere. Right. And that's how missionaries and Christians, how their mind works. It's cognitive dissonance, circular reasoning. Which is, the definition of circular reason is, and I can say it like this, your conclusion is always going to come back to your conclusion. And we've all experienced this before. But it can only work if we all believe the same thing. So if I believe a certain thing, and I'm trying to prove it to you, I'm always going to go back to that thing to prove itself. But I'm going to use a little bit of proof texting to back it up. Anybody following me? I'm going to pull a scripture here, a thought here, or whatever. So the problem I had this weekend was dealing with my grandmother is, well, the scripture says, Shema Yisrael, Yahweh Eloheinu, Yahweh Chad, Heo Yisrael, Yahweh, the Lord our God, in English, or how they translate it, is one. She said, yeah, he's one, but he's three. I was like, okay. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. I said, I have a question. Why are you limiting him to three? Well, in the New Testament, in Hebrews, where's that in the Old Testament? Because the New Testament has to stand empirically on the Old Testament. Right? Yeah. I said, why are you limiting the Most High? He's infinite. And I guess the concept is no one ever thinks to say, well, why are you breaking them down to three? Yes, sir?
And not 100.
And not 100. Not two. Not four. Not 20. Not 15. But three. And this is what I'm saying. Empty yourself. Throw your beliefs out the door and just think for me. I need to think. Okay? So,
I want to give an example. Has everybody seen Star Trek before? Okay. Yes, the new one or the old one? Really interesting, because if you understand how Captain Kirk works, mm-hmm. Captain Kirk is very imaginative. Mm-hmm. But then Spock is always like, Captain, that's logically impossible. Kirk like, man, get out of here. And then possibly, but it had to be a balance, because sometimes you listen to Spock, then sometimes Spock just got to do what he's going to do. And it works out, you know. So I just want to add that back to the cognitive.
That's another message, balance. You can't be too much this way. You can't be too much this way. You gotta have a balance.
Right.
How else can Yahweh be righteous? Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? He makes life. He makes death. He makes good. He makes evil. You know what I'm saying? We have to be balanced. You know what I'm saying? You have to have a perfect balance of spirituality, and we're here, we're physical, we're in this physical place. We can see, we can touch, taste, you know, everything, smell. Where's your balance? Or are you going to be a hermit? You're so spiritual, you're a hermit.
And what's funny is they ride on a ship that's shaped like a brain.
Hey, I never thought about that.
That's interesting. All right. So, circular reasoning is a logical fallacy in which the reasoner, the person reasoning, making their point, begins with what they're trying to conclude or end with, meaning you start in a place already, you start in a place where you already believe, And what is unsubstantiated in your belief, you're using that belief as proof of itself. Who can say back to me what I just said?
Sorry. You said.
Go ahead, okay.
You said, what you just said was, you start your journey.
Tell me in your own words.
My own words? Mm-hmm.
You're teaching me. That's it.
So, I mean, like, you've already concluded the beginning of your conversation.
Right.
So, whatever, you know, from this point on, you know, there's nothing else to talk about because you've already said that this is what it is.
You have already established your conclusion. You're not trying to show me how you came to the conclusion. You're using your conclusion to show me your conclusion. It's circular. You're starting here. But you're going back here to prove here. That's how your reasoning works. Mm-hmm. Yes.
But isn't that what the word does? The word starts you here. And it brings you all the way back to there. Once again, makes it complete.
What do you mean?
The word starts in Torah.
Okay.
It don't start in Torah. Actually, it starts with the beginning of the world.
Okay.
And then after the death of the world,
So what you just said, you could walk me through it through scripture.
Yes.
Yes. Right?
Yes.
But if you had something that's not in the scripture, right?
Right.
And you're trying to prove it.
Right.
I understand what you're saying. You're applying a universal principle to the concept of reasoning. I'm talking about reasoning. That's a principle. Meaning we start from the creator, and we end up going back to the creator. That's pretty much what you just said without, you know, with all the extra, you know, everything else. But I'm talking about a form of thinking. Meaning, you could show me in a normal reasoning, actually it'd probably be going like this. This is the conclusion. Let me see. I'm going this way, and I'm hitting these wickets. And you could show me 1, 2, 3. Or conclusion. You can show me that. But in circular reasoning, it doesn't work that way. You're using this to be your end all be all. You're not showing me anything. You're just using this. You're showing me this. You don't understand?
I mean, if it's me that's showing, if I'm showing you what I want you to see, then yes, that's me showing you what I want you to see. That's something. I'm showing you what the Most High say, that's another story. It's not me that's showing it to you, it's him that's showing it to
you. But you may believe something that's outside of what the Most High said.
Well, that's what I said. If it don't come full circle back to what he said, then it's not him. And you got to be able to accept that. So a lot of us can't accept the fact that if it don't line up with what Torah says, or if it don't do what Torah says, or if it don't bring you back to the Most High, then it's probably not.
Right, now watch this. What you just said kind of summarized it. You know, I'm using you from what you said. You know that everything that's in the Torah needs to lead you back to the Most High, right?
Right, yeah.
So if somebody comes to you with something that doesn't necessarily jive with what the Most High said,
right,
and you want to believe it, you're going to make it come from the Most High in your mind. You're going to make it to fit what you want to believe. You're going to make it fit. You're going to do that on your own. That's how circular reasoning is. That's cognitive dissonance. Meaning, really, the thought is you already started believing something, right? You already believe it. You walked away from whatever it is you came from before, but you still believe this concept. So now you're understanding it's a culture that comes with the concept, so you're trying to rationalize that concept and make it fit in the culture when it may not fit. It's circular reasoning. You want to believe it, but it doesn't fit. Because of everything else that's substantiatable, it doesn't definitively say what you two want to believe. It doesn't say that. Yes? Explain.
The theory that we all come from monkeys.
Right.
You understand what I'm saying?
That's a good one.
So, you know, the theory that we all come from monkeys, I've seen a whole bunch of stuff just with that alone. But that's the set thing. You understand
right.
what I'm saying? So
finding a bunch of bones.
Right.
The oldest bones in Africa. Oh, see, that shows you. Black people, we all come from Africa. Everybody comes from Africa. The oldest humanoid, not human, humanoid bones come from Africa. So that proves in itself that we all come from Africa.
Right. So it's like the conclusive stand is the hypothesis, it's the theory, it's the scientific proof, it's the archaeology, it's all of that. You know what I'm saying? It's every wicked point is going to, you see right there, man, that concludes the fact of what I just said. Evolution must be true. They evolved from monkeys.
Mind you, there's no missing link. Everybody know what a missing link is, right? It's some bones that's in between monkey, in between man. It's the evolutionary in between. They haven't found that. But they're telling you that you come from a monkey. You evolved from an ape man.
Nothing in reality is right in front of you. The reality of it, that doesn't make any sense.
But it makes sense to the people that believe it. Who had the hand up over here first? Was it you?
Yeah. I guess when talking to the children's dad about the whole thing, well, we don't want them to eat the pork. And then the whole concept pretty much is when I talk to them, everything is
pretty much what you're saying is like nothing can stand on its own without you having to say your conclusion. So say you give a scripture and you read the scripture and
are you saying proof texting? You pull a scripture.
Yeah, okay.
Now I'm gonna explain. Proof texting is you pull a scripture out of context. Whether it's out of context in the English or if it's out of context in the Hebrew or the Greek or whatever it came from. It's out of context. But you're using it to prove something else that has nothing to do with anything else. But go ahead.
That was it?
Okay.
I was forced to film a little bit. And I said the day there.
Right.
I heard some of you. Right. A lot of them went. And that's why I feel out of the way because it's not, you have to read the whole thing in context. Mm-hmm. And even have to read the whole thing in context, and maybe words
I mean, we could get it. We could get into helping the sister on the issue later, but right now we're trying to stick with the point,
right.
The point of what dissonance is. You understand? And go ahead. Yes, you had your hand up, right?
Okay.
Yes.
But circular reasoning happens for everybody, but the only way that's detrimental to you is if your conclusion is incorrect.
It's detrimental to you when you have cognitive dissonance. That's when it's detrimental to you, when reality of things is not jiving with your belief. You're not here. You're in your own world. You are making up things, and that's your reality. That's when it's detrimental to you, because you may be going in the wrong direction. You may be going the right direction, but you may be going in the wrong direction based on what's already been laid out for you to go. Does that make sense?
That makes sense. I would say that it's detrimental if what you stand on is invalid or not true. But everybody does certain reasons. Their conclusion, pretty much, okay, I'm going to write. So everything that you write has to line up with your conclusion. And all of your facts and stuff that you put in the body paragraphs, they point toward your conclusion, which is why the conclusion you put it there. But if your conclusion is wrong, then it doesn't work. But if your conclusion is right, you're still doing circular reasoning regardless.
If your conclusion is right, you're still doing circular. No, it doesn't work that way.
Why not?
This is what I'm saying. If I didn't think we were going to get stuck on these two parts that's long, but if you have history, archaeology, and it came, but you have an order. You have an order of your proofs, right? Versus you have one proof. It's no different than proof texting. This criteria has a history that goes behind it. It has information. It has contemporaries, meaning around that time, these things were known to have happened in other places, so on and so forth. These are your wickets. And the circular reason, it's more of you pulling out one instance out of that crack in time, and you build upon that. And it doesn't necessarily, only thing you can say is, it happened. But everything else that you've built around it, it's no way to prove that except in itself. Except in that one point that you pulled out and keep going around in a circle with that thing.
This is what I see. If your set theory is based on proof texting, mm-hmm. then it will therefore hinder or block your circular reasoning. You see what I'm saying?
Can
which will also mess up your cognitive dissonance.
Okay. Now. Okay. Everybody understand cognition. I'm trying to move forward. Dissonance. Right? A circular reasoning. Who does not, still doesn't understand?
I'm not clear on that.
Okay. Circular reasoning is, you have a conclusion, right? And you're using your conclusion to make your point. But it only works if I believe it.
Right.
So I'm gonna do this. I'm gonna do this. And I know this is no surprise to anybody. I don't look at the New Testament as scripture. Does everybody know that?
Okay.
Because I do not look at the New Testament as scripture. All right? Because in what we call the New Testament, they're quoting from the scripture. Everybody following me? A scripture is something that somebody, follow me. A scripture or a holy scripture is what somebody holds as set apart or sanctified. Rules, laws, history, so on and so forth, that they follow as a guideline for what they trust in. Is everybody following? Okay? And that goes to Malak. Where do you go? Could you pull up that thing I'm going to show you?
Actually, pull up early.
Now, does anybody disagree that there would be no New Testament if you didn't have the scripture? Right. So, if I'm talking to a Christian, a Messianic Hebrew, or whatever, I don't like these terms. We all Hebrews. We're all Israelites. And I'm asking them to show me why they believe what they believe. And they pull one text, and they try to stand on that, or maybe two or three. Because here's the thing about scriptures and prophecy and what it says. Anything that's important in Torah or Tanakh repeats itself over and over and over and over and over and over again. Because it's important. It's detrimental for your salvation. Are you following me? Thus saith Yah. Right? When you tell me that, well, in the book of Hebrews it says, and I'm like, well, where they get that from in Hebrews? Well, in Corinthians it says, well, where did they get that from in Corinthians? Well, the Bible says, well, the thing that you have to understand, if you listen to a Jew, they say the Hebrew Bible. And then a Christian or a person that believes in both sides of the book, they say the Bible, right? The thing is, the word Bible just means many books, biblios, right? So you need to understand that from my standpoint, you have scriptures, and you could call that the Bible or the Hebrew Bible. You could call the New Testament the Bible because it is many books. You pull up? So you have to take me on a journey. And I did a lesson on this years ago, and I try to keep refreshing it. Is that when the powers that be gave us the Bible, they only gave you the New Testament. Remember, we're all blank right now. Follow me. They gave you the New Testament. You believed in the New Testament, or you believe, you come to believe. 5 to 10 years later, they added the Old Testament to it. The missionaries, I wish I had the guy's name, I wrote down a whole other pamphlet, says that your belief hangs on the balance of your belief. Everything in the Old Testament hangs on your balance of your belief. Because if you knew the scriptures before, it's probably be harder for somebody to convince you of something in the New Testament. Does that make sense? You already believed in the New Testament, so then you went back and made your belief fit in the Old Testament. And I'm going to prove that right now. All right. Follow me. You don't know anything. You're a blank slate. Right? What are the first four books of the Bible? Or the New Testament? The New Testament. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Scroll down. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. Wait. Scroll. You're going the right way.
The first five books.
It doesn't matter. No, I'm just kidding. All right. This is the New Testament. When was the temple destroyed?
70 AD.
The book of the Gospel of Matthew is dated 80 to 90 CE. The Gospel of Matthew is dated 80 to 90 CE. Common era. After the temple was destroyed. Right? This is the earliest known fragment, meaning from this point of origin, where it was created or it's proposed to have been created, 80 or 90 CE, right? The earliest fragments or what they have to the closest original documents is only dated to 150 to 200 Common Era. Follow me. 80 to 90 CE, this is based on three strands of evidence. This is how you do textual criticism or analyzing what you believe in or what you trust in. Use what Yah gave you first. Don't go spiritual first and then come around and say, all right, I can see it. Use what he gave you. He gave you sense. The setting of Matthew reflects the final separation of the church and the synagogue. They say Israelites, Peter, so on and so forth, and a split between the congregation to the Gentiles. If you want to say that. Somebody say they understand?
Who's the two people?
All right. If you go to the book of Acts, right, it goes into Acts. The separation between the Torah keeping believers in Yeshua versus, well, the Gentiles don't have to do all that stuff. That they just call them the two churches. One in Jerusalem and one abroad. Okay. So it reflects the final separation of the church and the synagogue. About 85 Common Era, it reflects the capture of Jerusalem and the destruction of the temple by the Romans in 70 CE. It uses Mark, it's usually dated around 70 CE as its source. So what they're saying is you have Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. When you compare these scriptures, they're saying that Matthew actually got a lot of information from Mark, whoever that author is. I don't know who it is. I know what it says. Are you following me? But if you already believe what it says, it was Mark. It was Matthew. Matthew wrote that book. No. Whoever wrote Matthew took their information from Mark because Mark existed before Matthew. You see what I'm saying? But I erased it. Dissidents would say, well, you know, several people probably knew the story and they saw it differently. And we can get into that later. Now, if this is 80 CE to 90 CE, right? The temple is destroyed, right? It's prophecies or alleged prophecies that are said in these writings. I keep going. I'll get back to that. The Gospel of Mark. It was written, the earliest where they guesstimate is 68, 70 CE. When was Yeshua crucified? Anybody know circa what?
33.
About 33. So this is well after. Everybody following? References to persecution and to war in Judea suggest that its contents was either Nero's persecution of Christians in Rome or the Jewish revolt. All right? Nero was the emperor of Rome. Okay? The earliest known fragment is 250 CE, meaning the oldest piece that they could find is dated here. And that's not original. That's a copy of a copy of a copy of a copy. That the original starts here, between 60 and 70. The Gospel of Luke, 80 to 90 CE, with some scholars suggesting around 90 to 100. So it could be here or it could be a little bit later. There's evidence, both textual, that the conflicts between Western and Alexandrian manuscripts families and from the Marcionite controversy was a second century heretic who produced his own version of Christian scripture based on Luke's gospel and Paul's epistles. And that Luke to Acts was still being substantially revised, meaning changed. Well into the second century. So we're dealing with 175 to 250 CE. I'm dealing with this mindset. It's amazing. It's amazing when you ask, well, what the scripture says this, this, and this, and watch a person's reaction. When you see that little glitch in the matrix, you say, you see that feeling right there? That's dissonance. You're gonna come up with a reason to explain it away. I've done it. Because it has to be harmonious in your mind. Scroll up a little bit more. The Gospel of John, dated 90 to 110 CE. The upper date based on textual evidence that the Gospel was known in the early 2nd century and the lower on the internal reference to the expulsion of Christians from synagogues. All right, so this is a little bit later. The earliest fragments is 120 to 60 CE, Common Era. Yes.
Mm-hmm. So, like, with those dates and stuff, don't you think that they should be, like, swapped? Some of them are, like,
Wait. That's the point. I'm going to make a, it's coming to a point. The book of Acts, 95 to 100 CE. If Acts uses Josephus as a source, it has been proposed that it must have been composed after 90 CE. It does not show any knowledge of Paul's letters. Hold that point in your mind. Which also supports a late date, and the social situation is one in which of the faithful need shepherds to protect them from heretical wolves. Which again reflects the late date. It's a certain concept that wasn't really around until that time period. That's what it's saying. Meaning, I gotta make sure you understand it my way, or the way that I feel is more in line with my belief, the church's belief, or whatever. So they call it shepherds, or you know the other word for it in Greek, protecting the people from wolves. Watch this. Romans. Who wrote Romans? Who wrote the book of Romans?
Paul.
It doesn't say Paul? It's attributed to Paul. 57 CE. What's your mind saying to you right now? What's the dissonance that you're going through? That feeling in your mind, trying to figure this out, trying to make it line up for you? What's that saying right there? This is supposed to be attributed to Paul. Scroll back up the dome. Scroll back up. Acts 100, 90, 70, 90. Go back to Paul. Romans, it's 57. 57 CE. What's wrong with this picture?
Get the scale of confused, right? So the higher the number,
the more closer you come into us.
Okay, so the lower the number,
the further back you go.
Okay. Alright, so all this stuff was broke
after Paul's writing.
So who really writing this stuff? Because they can't be.
Listen, I'm just giving you information. You do with it what you want to. This is your dissonance. You gonna how to make it fit what you want to believe, or you gonna search it out and figure it out?
So the question you say Romans was wrote in 57,
uh-huh,
which was
further away from us from now. But Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John is closer.
Matthew, Mark, Luke, okay.
Come on, work with me. What's going through your mind? Meaning, the first books of the New Testament are newer,
right,
and the later, some of the later books are earlier. So now, what comes first? Logically, what's? I don't know who's writing it. I don't know. That's not for me. I know what it says, but it's a book. It's a lot of people that's using this as scripture.
I have a question.
Yes.
We have what we call storytellers. They have storytellers. They have an opinion.
Griots.
And these people, they keep records accounts of history for certain people for periods of time. Now, when we look at this, I know a lot of scripture. And I don't have the answer whether they got this information from who passed these things down from generation to generation.
Mm-hmm.
Could that be an answer?
That's a good guess. Let's suppose that all make, you know, that's what, if somebody's passing it on, right? Somebody had to put these books in the way you're reading it in order.
Well, we know who did that. Constantine did that.
Actually, I don't know if Constantine did that. That's what we're told as far as when we get into Catholicism, but up until that point, Christianity, or that the religion of Christianity, had flourished. You had different versions of Christianity. You had some of these books was already a Bible.
We also know that Hebrew was Christian as
well. We knew that Hebrew, the Hebrews were Torah believing. That gets in a whole other area of dissonance. But they were Torah-keeping Hebrews. And then they were non-Torah-keeping Gentiles. That's what I know. right? And then after a certain point, outside of when you start seeing these Gentiles come in, that's when you really stop hearing about Torah keeping Hebrews. I mean, Christians.
A Christian Torah keeping Hebrews.
Right.
Right there.
All right. But my point, we could get back into the Torah keeping, non-Torah keeping, Christian, whatever. The point is that Paul's writings precede the Gospels.
I understand that doesn't make sense.
It doesn't make sense.
Why?
Because it's called forensic looking at the scriptures and looking at it for what it's saying, right? And I'm going to give you a point. The conclusion should be that the earliest writings are more in line with what actually happened to the time period of when Jesus, Yeshua, passed away. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
The earliest writings should be more in line or in order with what happened closest to that time. If you died, right? Y'all forbid. Something happened to you. And I'm previous. I'm going to write it as closest to the time period of what happened.
Okay, so I'm still trying. I have a disconnect.
The further you go away, it leaves room for more error or more adding or more subtracting or more anything. The closer you are, this is how historians look at text. So the fact would be Paul's writings would be more accurate than the gospel. Because he was closer to the time. He would tell a story more in line with what happened than somebody else writing a story.
I get that. What I'm trying to figure out is that they're telling two separate things. So they're not even talking about the same thing at all.
Right.
So I'm trying to understand.
Right. They're telling two separate things. They're not even talking about the same thing at all. If I am closer to the time period, I still have a duty as a record keeper to keep it closest and accurate to what's happening. That's a given. You don't get it. I got you.
Yes,
but I'm explaining. Yeah. Yes.
Thank you. All right. More. I understand what you. I'm following, right?
Tracking.
Here's my dissonance, though.
Okay. Dissonance.
So we know the setting, right?
Okay.
Romans under Roman control at that time.
Mm-hmm.
Even before the destroying of the temple, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yahushua still alive then. Now he passed away. So at that time, the Israelites were actually in hiding compared to Shaul, who was a dual citizen.
Okay.
Now at that time, he can go here and there. And his writings were a little more published at that time.
Okay.
Now with the writings of Yahushua, It was so important to keep that trace of books guarded, Shamar, that it had to be passed along to somebody who kept on in hiding. You know, I mean, that's my dissonance about it. That's why it was published a little later.
That makes sense what you're saying? To you.
That's my dissonance.
That makes sense to you. That's what you're saying. Okay. All right. It doesn't make sense to me. I'm not saying it to not what you're saying.
Oh, no, yeah.
I mean, I'm not saying you're wrong.
Right.
I'm saying it doesn't make sense to me. It may make sense to somebody else, but it may not make sense to the other person. Because logically, again, if something happens, the earliest writings should be more in line with what happens. Now, what you're saying is people went into hiding. That's not what these dates are saying. These dates are actually saying this is the time period they came out. So now the dissonance will probably be, and this is my dissonance to make it make sense, is that, well, kind of like what you said, people probably passing this down underground and so on and so forth. And then by 80, 90, even though Paul, according to what you said, he's free. His writings are published all over, right? But somebody else came out later and said, this is how it really happened. Or this is how it happened for us, or whatever. I'm not here to rationalize it. I'm here to give you facts. How you weigh it out in your mind, that's on you. Because no matter what I say, you're going to believe what you want to believe. I'm just giving you facts. You see the difference? That's why I say empty yourself. Just look at the facts. Okay. Corinthians 56. Another of the genuine. Oh, I didn't even get into this. we quote Paul, we quote all of, a lot of Paul's writings. There's 14 books attributed to Paul in the New Testament, right? Only 7 of them are confirmed Paul's writings. This is scripture. So we're quoting Paul's writings, but do you even know which ones are Paul's writings? Do you know? But you might be quoting it. You might be admonishing somebody according to it. For me, Adon Baruch may write a book or write, Moreh, Baruch, COY, so on and so forth. He wrote a 25-page epistle to the Assembly of COY. 200 years later, somebody finds his writings. Man, this is awesome. The epistle of Moreh Baruch, and they put it with the Biblios or the Bible. Is it scripture? It may be for somebody. Y'all following me? Y'all following me? That's why when you start looking at these different Christianities, lost Christianities and so on and so forth, there's many scriptures. I mean, a lot of them are a lot later. Some of them are around the same time period. But someone put these together the way they wanted to, in the order that they wanted to convey a thought. All right, let's keep going. Galatians, 55 CE, again, earlier than the Gospels. Paul does not express any wish to revisit the church in Galatia, which he founded. And so some scholars believe the letter dates from the end of his missionary work. The letter concerns the question of whether Gentile converts are required to adopt full Jewish customs. So this was as early as 55 CE. This is before the destruction of the temple. Before the destruction of the temple. Keep scrolling up. Okay. Ephesians, it's a little bit.
Ephesians,
80 to 90 CE. The letter appears to have been written after Paul's death. Huh? What? In Rome by an author who uses his name.
Wait a minute.
Wait, what? Facts.
You know, or so they should have some type of proof of actually who's handing these.
No, they don't. They don't.
But how can you say that Paul, you can put a name on it?
Somebody put a name on it. I didn't put a name on it. I just know this. So where I stand firm on is based on what I know. And you can only stand firm on what you know and what you don't know. Which is what? Go ahead.
Which is still what someone told you.
Right. So, yeah, somebody told you the Torah. Yeah, somebody brought you to Tanakh.
Yeah, so at the end of the day,
dissidents. Come on, hit me with it. Hit me with it.
But at the end of the day, if we don't know who wrote it,
mm-hmm.
and they say Paul didn't write it, and they don't know who wrote it, mm-hmm. how can they say Paul didn't write it?
Because that's a great one, that's one. That's a great question. Hold on. I got the
And if the earliest fragments are in the last rows of the second or third century CE, how do they know that they were created around this time period?
Give me one second. I wrote it down here. Okay.
No noise is on camera.
Criteria. That's what you want to know. How do they know and how do they don't know? How do they figure this? How do they figure that? It's criteria that's used when these people, the problem that we get is because we're taught the way we're taught, how to look at the scriptures and so on and so forth, is that we automatically assume that people are doing it just to disprove the scriptures or just to disprove the Bible. Some people actually go into this to prove the Bible. You have two sides. You got people that's trying to disprove it. You got people that's trying to prove it. So they have to come to some kind of consensus, both parties, on what they agree upon. This is how we're gonna do this. So when we bring it to the table, we can argue the same exact points. One second. They use internal evidence, right? Internal evidence consists of whether the author tells us about himself explicitly. Examples, because the author of the Epistle of the Hebrews never identified himself or herself, scholars as early as Origen, which is a church father, of Alexandria, or they call him a church father, in the 3rd century suspected that Paul was not the author. So he already said it back then.
He suspected.
So they used that in weighing what other evidences they have. And I'm going to continue going with the evidence. They use external evidence. It consists of references, either explicit or implicit, to the text, especially during the earliest times, by those who had access to reliable sources now lost. Implicit references would be mentioned in the text by letter or name. So you might have a church father that's dated to like 100 that talks about this scripture, that it existed and they knew Paul wrote it. And there may be some other people that were using it at the time that knew that Paul wrote it. They used these as well. So, letter by name or recognizable form of the text. Implicit reference are quotations from Paul, especially indirect or attributed or expressing ideas and phrases that appear in his works. So using what you already know belongs to Paul, for sure, and looking at how it's written. It flows like Paul. It's no different than you hear somebody that has my voice, but they're using, you never heard me talk like that, if that makes sense. You understand? Historical setting. That's how they knew if a person is dead around the time period, what was going on. It's used to determine the date and possible authorship. Does that make sense? So they're using the setting in the writing to say yay or nay. If he's talking about, let's just say, I don't know. No. I'm trying to give a good example. If he's saying this is the gospel according to Paul, and he's talking about, I'm just going to shoot in the dark, him seeing Moshe. He was at the mountain giving the commandments, and he was there. We knew it wasn't Paul just by the date don't add up. That was thousands of years or hundreds of years before Paul ever existed. Stuff like that. So if he's talking about if a person is talking about the destruction of the temple, and there's already dated later or let's say earlier, but they're writing like they were there, but they weren't even born yet, then we knew they weren't there. That's not them. It couldn't have been this person, or they couldn't have been there. Does that make sense? That's how you use history. Language and style, vocabulary, sentence structure, employment of idioms, and common phrases. I tell you one thing Paul says a lot of. He says a lot of I. He does say a lot of I. All right? Contents and theology. A consistent point of view is consistent. Implies a common author. Contradictory or unrelated teachings imply multiple authors. So these are the criteria that people use, or these scholars use, to determine who did write it or who didn't. Outside of a name, or they didn't give me a name, so because they didn't give me a name, I'm going to keep sticking with it being Paul. You can choose to do that. Okay? So where were we? Boom. Letters appear to be in Paul. Okay, we have the Philippians. So Ephesians. Come down. Ephesians is later. Or closer to us, then we go to Philippians. It's early again. A genuine letter, a genuine Pauline letter. It mentions Caesar's household, leading some scholars to believe it was written from Rome. But some of the news in it could not have come from Rome. It seems rather to date from an early imprisonment, perhaps in Ephesus, from which Paul hopes to be released. All right, so they kind of narrow down which imprisonment or which part in Rome over that point that this might have been written in. Again, this precedes the Gospels. Keeps going up. Colossians, 62 to 70 CE. Oh, sorry. Some scholars believe Colossians date from Paul's imprisonment in Ephesus around 55 CE, but differences in theology suggest that it comes from much later in his career around the time of his imprisonment in Rome. So it may have been a shift in something that he was saying. That's what they base it on. All right. Thessalonians, 51 CE, one of the earliest of the genuine Paul's writings. If I'm not mistaken, is that the earliest? No, it's Corinthians. No, it's one of the earliest. That's 1 Thessalonians, 2 Thessalonians, 51 CE or post 70 CE. If this this is a genuine Pauline epistle. It flows closely, it follows closely on 1 Thessalonians, but some of the language and theology point to a much later date from an unknown author using Paul's name. The language doesn't jive with Paul. The theories don't jive with Paul. And that's what I say, if we're gonna use Paul's writings, make sure we know which ones that we can say this is more leans towards Paul versus somebody that we don't know. We don't know what he's saying. That's where a lot of confusion comes in. When you're, well, can we eat what we eat? Well, we know that. We know that. But Christians are confused because some of these things do contradict each other. Is it works? Is it not works? I don't know.
Well, it's Paul never said a lot of stuff. Job never said a lot of stuff.
How do you know?
Because when you really read what he's written, he leaves it back for when it's all said and done. And if you read, he leaves you back for.
So you're equivalently sure about that?
I'm just saying what is written. He leaves you. What I'm saying, he does leave you back to Torah. And I'm saying that people, when you read it, it sounds manipulative, but when you break it down and study it, especially I think in Romans 9 and stuff like that, he's not telling people that you shouldn't keep Torah. He's telling people that he wouldn't know Torah. He wouldn't know sin if it had not been for Torah.
I guess the question I'm asking is, which ones, you said Romans, so that's fine. Which ones are Paul's and which ones are not? And do all of them tell you to go back to Torah? As far as your reading?
Well, what I see the people, if it don't lead you back to Torah. Whatever written in the New Testament, as they call it, are the apocryphal, or not apocryphal, whatever written in the New Testament, are the gospel. They couldn't have done nothing other than what Yah commanded. If you do anything other than what Yah commanded, it's an error. If it don't lead you back to Yah, Yah's way is wrong. But if it leads you back to Yah, Yah's way is right. Because it got to come back to Him.
Alright. And I'm not banging on you or anything. I'm just using what you're saying as an example. So what you're saying is,
this is not Paul's gospel.
I don't know whose gospel it is. I say
that's
that.
That's what I'm saying.
What I'm saying is this, one, are you looking at it as scripture? That's the first question I would have to ask. Are you looking at it as scripture? And if you are, to me, that's a dangerous concept to throw out there. So what you're saying is it's scripture. I'm just playing it back how I'm hearing it. And if anybody hears me, like, nah, that's not what Luke Cain's saying, or I'm not saying this is what you're saying, but this is how I'm hearing it. Well, it's how I'm interpreting what you're saying. If I look at it as scripture, then I'm going to pick what isn't sound with the rest of the scriptures and use what leads me back to the rest of the scriptures. But it's scripture to me. You understand what I'm saying?
Anything you read in our history book, and I tell people, anything you read in our history book, if it don't lead you back to the word of the Most High, if it's in disagreement with the word of the Most High, or it don't lead you back to the word of the Most High, then it didn't come from Him. But anything anybody say or do has to come from the Most High. It has to come back now. It don't come back to Him, it has to come back from Him. Because the word don't. Word goes forward, and it goes throughout the whole world. And anybody who does anything other than what he says is not right.
So I guess that the big question is, what's our history book? Because you have many books, and some is our history, and some is mingled history of different people and stuff,
right,
and how they look at things,
right,
and so on.
And
so so what's our history book?
That's why you have to separate the wheat from the tare. You have to separate the good from the bad. You have to recognize what is told and what is wrong. You have to recognize. And the only way to recognize that is to reconcile back to the Torah.
Which is what we strive to do here. That's why we say study your Torah, study your Tanakh. So when you get to this point, you don't get thrown all over the place. But I guess the bottom line is that, is this scripture? Is it scripture? Is it something you can take the chance to stand on 100, I say 100%. Because again, what's Paul's writings? How do you know that Paul, first of all, you have to, and I talked to Baruch about this before I left, we have to know what Paul's writing is to say what he said or what he didn't say. We have to know what Paul's writing is to say he's pointing me back to Torah. Unless all the ones attributed to Paul are pointing us back to Torah. I don't know. I'm going to let you know which ones are attributed to Paul and then, in a few. Which ones are, they say these seven are Paul's writing. All right, where were we? Timothy? First Timothy, Second Timothy, and Titus, 100 CE. The two Timothy's epistles and Titus reflect a much more developed church organization than they're reflected in the genuine Pauline's epistles. So these are not genuine. This is later on. This is an established religion already, or theories or concepts and so on. Philemon, 55, so it's early again. 54 and 55, a genuine Pauline epistles written from an imprisonment, probably in Ephesus, that Paul expects will soon be over. Hebrews, it's a good one. Everybody quotes Hebrews. Hebrews what, 9:22? Without the blood, there's no remission of sins. Where did they quote it from? Leviticus chapter 17. Does it say the same thing? Well, read it to yourself. All right. 80 to 90 CE, the elegance of the Greek and the sophistication of the theology, but it's Hebrews, so it could be a Hellenistic Jew. You can say that. That helped the dissidents, right? The elegance of the Greek and the sophistication of theology do not fit the genuine Pauline epistles, but the mention, okay, maybe that's the mention of Timothy in the conclusion led to its being included in the Pauline group from an earlier date. Book of the Hebrews. A lot of Hebrews, I got hit with that all week, all the comments I had. Well, Hebrews said, read Hebrews, it says it. Yeah, okay, I gotta believe Hebrews. Scroll up. For me to come into the same cognizance, the same place as you, I have to first believe it. That's how, I have to first believe it. Once I believe, I will start seeing exactly what you see. All right, James. 65 to 85 CE, like Hebrews, James is not so much a letter as an exhortation. The style of the Greek makes it unlikely that it was actually written by James, the brother of Jesus. But it's James. Well, let's go to the book of James. The book of James says this. The book of James says this, the scripture. That's why I'm very careful on what I call scripture. 1 Peter. Dated 75 to 90 CE. No words on it. So, was it Peter? Was it not? That's when you get into the, you actually look into it. The scholars have mild disagreement that 2 Peter was actually written by Peter. They believe, and I don't say necessarily I agree with it, or I don't, I do or I don't. I'm just telling you what I know. And you can research it all for yourself. They say that they feel that it's a writer that supports Paul that's making it a flow of we all get along, we all on the same page. Does that make y'all follow me? Because in 2 Peter just said, it talks about Paul and, people that are unlearned, they twist the scriptures and so on and so on and so forth. All right? Keep it moving. 2 Peter. All right, that was first. Sorry. And this is apparently the latest writing in the New Testament. The latest. Quoting from Jude, assuming the knowledge of the Pauline letters, and including a reference to the gospel story of the transfiguration of Christ. The latest. Epistles of John, 90 to 100. The letters give no clear indication, but scholars lend to place them about a decade after the gospel of John, 10 years later. Jude, uncertain. The references to the brother of James and to what the apostle of our Lord Jesus Christ foretold suggest that it was written after the apostolic letters were in circulation, but before 2 Peter. So right before that, so it was pretty late. Like 100, it could be like 100 and 100, between 100 and 110. Okay. And Revelation 95 CE, this date is suggested by clues in the visions pointing to the reign of Emperor Domitian. So it was written in that time period of the Roman Emperor Domitian, pointing to the clues. Now, how does that work with dissonance? Scroll back to the top. So, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. All right. So, we understand that the flow of the scriptures, definitely I understand because my uncle, man, I got to tell you, that it's one that seems to more flow dealing with Israelites, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, right? Then when you get to the Pauline writings and certain other people, it speaks a little differently, right? The logical reasoning, logic, says that, again, like I was telling, speaking to Adone, that the earliest writings should reflect more of what happened around that time period versus the later writings reflecting something different. Example, Paul. This is a New Testament resurrection account timeline. Around 55 CE, 1 Corinthians 15. No physical appearance, no empty tomb. Right? Mark, around 70 CE, no appearances. Matthew, 80 CE, visionary appearances. Luke and John, 90 and 100, flesh and blood appearances. The further away from the actual events, the story kind of, you start seeing these physical resurrections. But the early events is more, of course, it's Paul. So the dissonance is going to try to make you make that fit however it fits. Yes.
Okay, had your hand up for a while.
Yes.
Go ahead. So in the Old Testament, starting from Adam and Eve, is the newest information we have?
No. No, 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 no. You're trying to figure out how the timeline works?
Right.
Okay, watch this. This is now 2016.
Yes.
Right? Uh-huh. This is, let's say this is 25 BC. Right? And then we got, let's say, you know, zero. Then you got 25. That's CE, common era. Then you have, let's say, 35 CE. Then you have, let's say, the timeline keeps going, you have 100, you know, 200. The more you come this way, it's closer to us. So if it's dated here, 25 or 55, it's further away from us. It's older. It precedes 100 coming this way.
Okay. So my question is, when they wrote the Old Testament, it was with the stats.
What are you asking?
Like the events between Adam and Eve, right. Cain and Abel, and as time went on, they were consistent. That was consistent in the right order that it happened.
The themes are consistent. The themes. No. Me, go ahead.
No, okay.
You said not what? If I said not.
No, go ahead. I'm going to listen first.
No, what were you going to say? Then maybe I might be going the wrong way.
Not the time, so each event didn't happen right after each other.
Not necessarily. To Deuteronomy, it's if you're a textual critic, you'll see that these events have happened and have been dictated. So they're always attributed to Moshe, right? And then Deuteronomy and Joshua is attributed to Yehoshua or Joshua, because of course Moshe passed away. So it's a sequential order of things, but it's different dispensation in time. And in some places, like in the book of Genesis, some things happen here, then they go here, and then they go here. That's not what this is about. All this stuff is fairly new in the last 2,000 years, right? Everything in Genesis, what we call the Old Testament, from Bereshit to Malachi, These are things that have already been written as far as scrolls. Now, I did a lesson on when they compiled it into what we consider the Tanakh and so on and so forth. I'm not visiting that today. But that's old stuff. This is fairly new stuff. And a new, depending on what you believe, understanding. And I'm gonna bring it all home because we didn't talk about the set theory.
Okay, so then the second question was,
go ahead.
How are they, what is their concept of how they, why did they put Matthew as the beginning of the old? But they should have
wait,
had,
at the beginning of what? The beginning of the new? All right. I can only give you, I can't tell you why they did it. I can only give you a reason based on a sound reasoning or judgment. And I'm not trying to give you all a reason. I'm painting a picture. I need to get you to believe something a certain way. And as you go on, because the order is based on you not knowing these dates, you're thinking this is a sequence of events.
Right.
Right? So you already believe in whatever has been told or written in the beginning of the book about Yeshua or Jesus. But then as you keep going, it's like, oh, the story just, it's not repeats. It's a little different. Because in these earlier books, it's talking about physical resurrection. Actually, they're actually the later books, but they're put earlier. And then in the earlier books, which are put place later, they're talking about spiritual resurrection. Are you following me? So, but today we only believe mostly in a physical. He rose again, and these different principles or these different thoughts. But these are actually more recent. Does that make sense? Yes.
Like books outside the Bibles, like a book like Josephus that talks about after 70 years, so on, so on.
Right. Those are
particularly the book of Josephus.
Okay.
If there's so much inconsistency in the New Testament, how about are there any inconsistencies in the book of Josephus?
There are. When I say inconsistencies, they talk about interpolation.
Right.
Meaning that certain places where you may see a name or whatever, they scholars will say the way it's put in there, the way it's said, it looks like it doesn't flow with what he's talking about. All right, it's like me saying yes, and you know, Yazakar, he was a strong leader and a wise man, and he had a brother named Daoud that did miracles, and then you know Yazakar kept going, and he was walking down the street and whatever. That's how off it's put in there. It's just a little statement. And it goes back to whatever he was talking about. So they say somebody probably put that in there. All right? Yes. Answer whose question? I didn't have a question.
But these books that you said you're reading right now, you're talking about ending up for the message. Like, all right.
What's your question? What's the thought? No. Go ahead. Finish your thought. Because I have an answer for something. But go ahead. Finish your thought. That's you. See, the question you're asking is questions that should be asked. Without fear of asking the question. Are y'all following me? We're rational. I understand the concept of you got to your creative side, but guess what? Your creative side helps you rationalize these things too. Make it true, right? I mean, the creative side helps you rationalize it to make it align. The point is, okay. All right. Book of, and I'm going to hold a question so I can get to, I want to wrap this up and then, you know, write your stuff down. Hope if you got something, write it down. But this is the Willie Lynch letter. My lips white. You know, I've been talking a lot. I might get parched. Earlier, we talked about the non-economic good of the horses and the nigger in their wild or natural state. We talked about the principle of breaking and tying them together for orderly production. Further, we talked about paying particular attention to the female. Okay. Matter of fact, I'm going to keep going. And then I'll keep going. The female savage and her offspring, orderly future planning. Then more recently, we stated that by reversing the positions of the male and the female savages, we have created an orbiting cycle. That's what we all have done. An orbiting cycle, meaning I give you something, you believe it. And if somebody comes, because remember, the New Testament protects itself. You know, if anybody comes, you know, other than through this way, they're a thief and a liar. So if somebody comes and says, well, brother, because it happened to me this weekend. I said, what did I say? He started walking on. He said, we were talking. So we reasoned for about 5-10 minutes. He said, let me ask you a question. Do you accept Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior? I said, absolutely not. No, I don't. He said, oh, that's all I had to. He started walking away. He dismissed me. He shut down immediately. What Bernie Mac said, immediately. I said, hold on, let me explain. And I had to explain to him, you know, I believe he existed and so on and so forth, but I don't believe that, you know, X, Y, and Z. And we actually had a dialogue. You understand what I'm saying? We had a good dialogue. But anyway, continuing on. We have created an orbiting cycle that turns on its own axis forever, according to these people. Until this phenomenon occurred and refreshed the position of the male and female savages. You're talking about a phenomenon. It says, our experts warn us about the possibility of this phenomenon occurring, for they say the mind has a strong drive to correct and recorrect itself over a period of time. It's a lot of stuff happening today. Today. If it can touch substantial, original, historical base, dang. Historical base, factual stuff, contextual stuff. Not pulling it from here, pulling it from there, and then you continuing your cycle of belief or whatever it is that you're doing. I don't know. I mean, I'm toasting on. if it can touch if it can touch substantial, original, historical base, and they advise us that the best way to deal with the phenomenon is to shave off the brute's mental history and create a multiplicity of phenomenon of illusions, that each illusion will twirl on its own orbit, something similar to floating balls in a vacuum. And I'm going to stop there. Wait, no. This creation of a multiplicity of phenomena, meaning, if you already believe it and somebody's showing you facts, it's gonna bother you. I've watched brothers. I've done it. And I come up with a new explanation that, like, bro, where you get that from? And it makes sense though. But it don't line up nowhere. It's what you believe. It's a circular reasoning. You have to make that feeling, that irritation of, you saying what I believe in? I've been putting my life on. No. And you're going to fix it to make it fit. The mind's going to do that. That's how the mind works. You are fighting against yourself. The dissonance is against you. this creation of a multiplicity of phenomena of illusions entails the principles. Anyway, that's pretty much it. It's talking about breeding with the horse and the savage. So, to end it, what I have to get into, to wrap this thing up, is the set theory. All right. So we got, it's called set theory. Okay?
We're going to put C right here. That's where it belongs, right there. You got A. And you got B. Now, I'm going to give scriptures to go with some of these. But it's not going to be exhaustive. It's not everything. I'm sure somebody ain't going to throw a scripture at me or whatever. That's not the purpose of this. I'm just trying to make a point. Dealing with your logic. What you do with your logic, that's your business. All right. All right, so how does the set theory work? The set theory is a group of theories, and we're using the scriptures for this example, that are based on, I'm gonna use the concept of Mashiach, or Messiah. First of all, everybody knows what the Messiah is, right? A Mashiach, person, place, or thing, anointed for the use of the Creator. To make it simple, right? Priests, temple, kings, utensils, so on and so forth. It was consecrated or anointed, which is where you get the word Christ in the New Testament, which means Christos, which means anointed in the Greek, right? Which is Mashiach. I'm going to give you set A. Let me make this a little smaller. Set A represents, I put set B like this. Set A represents all the scriptures pertaining to the Messianic age. All the scriptures. Okay? There's many, many scriptures that represents the Messianic age and talks about the Messianic age. Hold on. One second. You know what? It's Malachi. That's what's going on. All right. Okay. So, set A, it tells you all the scriptures representing the Messianic age. Everybody agrees on it. Everybody. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to give you some principles behind it. What makes it important? One, it has to be exhaustive. Somebody look that word up for me. Exhaustive. And then read it out. Two, it has to be clear and consistent. And three, it has to be empirically verifiable. This part, that one's going to be hard for a lot of people. Empirically verifiable. It means it's knowledge, not belief. It's what you know.
Okay. Exhaustive.
Exhaustive. What does exhaustive mean?
Exhaustive, meaning examining, including, or considering all elements or aspects.
That's what you have to examine.
Fully comprehensive.
Fully comprehensive. You have to analyze everything.
Complete.
Ooh. Completely. To the best of your ability. You know, depending on where you're at, you may just have the English, you got your concordance. Depending where you're at, you may study Hebrew. So you know Texan. I don't know all that yet. I expect to get there one day, but go ahead.
This one that says, before you judge any matter, you have to, essentially you have to hear both sides. You have to do it in full scope before you can make a decision.
Right. And all I'm doing here is giving you information. Right? All right. So it has to be exhaustive, clear, and consistent. Remember I said, things that are important for you, it repeats itself. It's exhaustive, goes through everything that it needs to go through the process of reasoning. It's clear and consistent, and it's empirically verifiable, meaning it's knowledge and not belief. Set A represents all the scriptures that is talking about a Messianic age. I'm going to run through them real quick. This is actually coming out of the Hebrew scriptures. So, if you go to it and it's off, I'll look at it again because usually what happens, it's a verse down or a verse or two down. Verse or two down. All right.
the ingathering of the Israelite nation. And these are the scriptures pertaining to that. Deuteronomy chapter 30:3. And Yahweh your Elohim will bring back your captivity and have mercy upon you, and he will gather you in from all the peoples to which Yahweh your Elohim scattered you. Deuteronomy 30:3. Isaiah 11:11-12. It shall be on that day that Yahweh will once again show his hand to acquire the remnant of his people who will have remained. He will raise a banner for the nations and assemble the castaways of Israel, and he will gather in the dispersed ones of Yehuda from the four corners of the earth. Isaiah 43:5-6. Fear not, for I am with you. From the east I will bring your offspring, and from the west I will gather you. I will say to the north, give them over. And to the south, do not withhold. Bring my sons from afar and my daughters from the ends of the earth. Yirmiyahu or Jeremiah, chapter 3:18. In those days, the house of Yehuda will walk with the house of Israel, and they will come together from the land of the north to the land that I have given as a possession to your fathers. Jeremiah chapter 30. And I'll repeat them, and, you know, if you ask questions or whatever, I have them for you after service. Jeremiah chapter 30, verse 3. For behold, the days are coming, says Yahweh, when I will return the captivity of my people, Israel and Yehuda, said Yahweh, and I will return them to the land that I gave their fathers, and they will possess it. Jehezekiel 11:17. Therefore, say, thus say Yahweh, Elohim, I will assemble you from the nations and gather you in from the lands where you have been scattered, and give you land, the land of Israel. Jehezekiel 34:13, or Ezekiel, I will remove them from the peoples and gather them from the lands and bring them to their soil. And I will tend upon them the mountains of Israel in the streams and in all the land's habitations. Jehezekiel 36:24, Ezekiel, I will take you from among the nations and gather you from all the lands, and I will bring you to your own soil. You can see reference on Ezekiel 37:21 as well. Jeremiah 32:37. Behold, I shall gather them back from all the lands which I have dispersed them in my anger, in my wrath, in my great fury, and I will return them to this place and cause them to dwell in security. That's one. That fits into this theory. Set A. The rebuilding of the temple, which you kind of touched upon earlier. Isaiah 2:2-3. It will happen in the end of days. The mountain of the temple of Yahweh will be firmly established at the head of the mountains, and it will be exalted above the hills, and all the nations will stream to it. Many peoples will go and say, come, let us go to the mountain of Yahweh, to the temple of the Elohim of Yaakov. Isaiah 60:7. All the flocks of Kedar will be gathered to you. The rams of Nebaioth will serve you. They will be brought up with favor upon my altar, and I will glorify the house of my splendor. You could also look at Isaiah 66:20. Jehezekiel chapters 40-44 describe how the third temple will be built and inaugurated. That's what we talked about earlier, right? Isaiah 56:6-7. And the foreigners who join themselves to Yahweh, to minister to him, to love him, love the name of Yahweh, and to be his servants, all who keep the Sabbath and do not profane it, and hold fast to my covenant, the strangers. These I will bring to my holy mountain and make them joyful in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and their sacrifices will be accepted on my altar, for my house will be called a house of prayer for all people. Malachi 3:4. Then the offering of Judah and Jerusalem will be pleasing to Yahweh, as in the days of old, as in former years. Zechariah 14:20-21. On that day there shall be inscribed on the bells of the horses, holy to Yahweh, and the cooking pots in the house of Yahweh, shall be as holy as the bowls in the front of the altar. And every cooking pot in Jerusalem and Yehuda shall be sacred to Yahweh of hosts, so that all who sanctify my name and use them to boil the flesh, the sacrifice, and there shall no longer be traitors in the house of Yahweh of hosts on that day. All right? That's it, set A. This is what we do know. Israelites, Jews, Christians, they all agree. No conflict. Observance of Torah. Interesting. Deuteronomy 30:8-10. You shall return and listen to the voice of Yahweh and perform all his commands that I command you this day. When you listen to the voice of Yahweh, your Elohim, to observe his commandments and his decrees that are written in this book of the Torah, when you shall return to Yahweh, your Elohim, with all your heart and all your soul. Jeremiah 31:32. For this is the covenant that I will seal with the house of Israel after those days, says Yahweh. I will place my Torah within them, and I will write into their heart, and I will be an Elohim for them, and they will be a people for me. Ezekiel 11:19-20. I will give them an undivided heart, and I will place a new spirit in them, and I will remove the heart of stone from their flesh and give them a heart of flesh, so that they may walk in my decrees and observe my laws and fulfill them. You can also look at Ezekiel 36:26-27. All right, this is unset A. Also in set A, it'll be a reign of peace. Micah 4:1-4. In the days to come, the mountains of Yahweh's house shall be established in the highest of the mountains, and shall be raised above all the hills, or above the hills. People shall stream to it, and many nations shall come and say, come, let us go to the mountain of Yahweh, to the house of the Elohim of Yaakov, that he may teach us his ways, and that we may walk in his path. For out of Zion shall go forth instruction and the word of Yahweh from Jerusalem. He shall judge between many peoples and shall arbitrate between strong nations far away, that shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nations shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war. Days, says Yahweh, I will place my Torah with... Oh, sneak up. I jumped off. They shall not learn war anymore, but they shall sit under their own vines and under their own flag, or fig trees, and no one shall make them afraid, for the mouth of Yahweh of hosts has spoken. You can also reference Isaiah chapter 2, verse 1-4, and chapter 65, verse 25. Hosea 2:20, I will make for them a covenant on that day with the wild animals, the birds of the air, and the creeping things on the ground, and I will abolish the bow and the sword and war from the land, and I will make them lie down in safety. Isaiah 32:16-18. Then judgment shall dwell in the wilderness, and righteousness remain in the fruitful field. And the work of righteousness shall be peace, and the effect of righteousness, quietness, and assurance forever. And my people shall dwell in a peaceable habitation, and in sure dwelling, and in a quiet resting places. Isaiah 60:18. Violence shall no more be heard in your land. Devastation or destruction within your borders, you shall call your walls salvation and your gates praise. Zechariah 14:11. And it shall be inhabited, for never again will it be doomed to destruction. Jerusalem shall abide in security. Jeremiah 33:9. And this will be for me, for the sake of rejoicing, for praise and for splendor before all the nations of the earth, who will hear about all the goodness that I will be doing for them, and who will fear and tremble over all the goodness and all the peace that I will do for it. All right? Set A. Everybody agrees. Everybody following what I'm going with this? It's going to be universal knowledge of Elohim. Zechariah 8:23. Thus says Yahweh of hosts, in those days, 10 men from every language shall take hold of a Yahudi, grasping his garment, saying, let us go with you, for we heard that Yahweh is with you. Zechariah 14:9, and Yahweh will become king over all the earth, and on that day Yahweh will be one, and his name one. Isaiah 66:23, and it shall come to pass that from one new moon to the other, and from one Sabbath to another, all flesh come worship before me, says Yahweh. Zephaniah 3:9, for then will I turn to the peoples, to a pure language, a pure language that they may call upon the name of Yahweh to serve him with one accord. Ain't gonna be, you believe this, I believe that, you believe, in that day. That's clear and consistent. It's gonna be empirically verifiable, meaning you're gonna know. You following me? You're not gonna believe, you're gonna know. Jeremiah 31:33. They will no longer teach every man his fellow, each man his neighbor, saying, "Know Yahweh, for they will all know me, from the least of them to the greatest," says Yahweh, "when I will forgive their iniquity and no longer recall their sin." Ezekiel 38:23, "I will exalt and I will sanctify and I will make myself known before the eyes of many nations. Then they will know that I am Yahweh." Zechariah 14:16, "It shall be that all who are left over from all nations who had invaded Jerusalem will come up every year to worship the King Elohim, Master of Legions, and to celebrate the Feast of Sukkot." Zechariah 14:16. Tehillim 86:9, "All nations you have made shall come and bow down before you, O Yahweh, and shall glorify your name." Okay. It's more, but these are the scriptures that are set A. So we have an understanding. We know what the Messianic age is supposed to look like. Everybody following me? We know it hasn't happened yet. That's pretty much, but we know what it's supposed to look like. That's what we're looking for.
Yeah.
Everybody agrees on that?
Yeah.
All right. Cain, and I'm telling you, everybody agrees on that.
Yeah.
Christian, Jew, Israelite, whatever. We all agree. Now, we're going to move on to set B. Set B is talking about the Davidic king, right? And I guess the what I have to tell you is there is no scripture that says HaMashiach. In Tanakh, there's no scripture that says HaMashiach in Hebrew, the Messiah. But we already kind of stated what Mashiach is. Everybody following me? The closest you get to HaMashiach, I think, is Hagadol or Sika. HaMashiach Hagadol. How you say it? It's the anointed high priest. So HaMashiach Hagadol. That's it. HaKohen HaMashiach, Slika. HaKohen HaMashiach, the anointed high priest. That's it. But with the scriptures that were given in set B, it gives you detail of who or the character of Mashiach that we're going to be looking for in this age, in this time period. This is what we know. Not what I believe or you believe or whatever. This is what we know. I'm going to give you some scriptures for that. Jews, Christians, Israelites. The Davidic king, and I don't know if I want to read all these. It's a lot of them. The Davidic king, Dawid, the promises made to Dawid. Going back to, the promises. Yeshayahu, chapter 11, verse 1 through 10. "A staff shall emerge from the stump of Yishai, and a shoot shall sprout from his roots. And the spirit of Elohim will rest upon him, a spirit of wisdom and understanding, a spirit of counsel and might, a spirit of knowledge and fear of Elohim. And he will be filled with the spirit for the fear of Yahweh, and will not judge by what his eyes sees, nor decide by what his ears hear. He will judge the poor and the righteous and decide with equity for the meek of the earth. He will strike the wicked of the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips he will slay the wicked. Righteousness will be a belt around his loins, and faithfulness the girdle around his waist. The wolf will live with the sheep, and the leopard will lie down with the kid, and a calf, a lion's cub, and a fatling will walk together, and a young child will lead them. A cow and a bear will graze, and their young will lie down together, and a lion will eat straw like a cattle. The nursing child will play by a viper's hole, and a weaned child will put his hand on the adder's den. They will neither hurt nor destroy in all of my holy mountain, for the earth will be filled of the knowledge of Yahweh, as the waters cover the sea. And it shall be on that day that the descendant of Yishai will stand as a banner for the peoples. Nations will seek him, and his resting place will be glorious." We all agree that's it's talking about what we know will be the Messiah. This special Messiah. Everybody follow? We know he's going to be the king of Israel, but we're going to keep it moving. Jeremiah chapter 23:5-6. "The days are surely coming, says Yahweh, when I will raise up for Dawid a righteous branch. He will reign as a king and deal wisely, and shall execute justice and righteousness in the land. In his days, Yehuda will be safe, and Israel will dwell securely. And this is the name by which he will be called: Yahweh is our righteousness." Jeremiah 37:10. "Alas, the day is so great that there is none like it. It is a time of distress for Yaakov, yet he shall be rescued from it. On that day, says Yahweh of hosts, I will break the yoke from his neck, and I will burst his bonds, and strangers shall no more make a servant of him. But they shall serve Yahweh the Elohim, and David their king, who I will raise up for them. But as for you, have no fear, my servant Yaakov, says Yahweh, and do not be dismayed, O Yisrael, for I am going to rescue you from far away, and your offspring from the land of their captivity. Yaakov shall return and take and have quiet and ease, and no one shall make him afraid. Yirmiyahu 33:14-17. The days are surely coming, says Yahweh, that Yahweh, your Elohim, when I will fulfill the promises that I have made to the house of Israel and the house of Yehuda in those days, and that the time I will call a righteous branch to spring up for Dawid, and he will execute justice and righteousness in the land. In those days, Yehuda will be safe, and Jerusalem will dwell in security. And this is the name by which it will be called. The Yahweh is our righteousness. Again, for thus says Yahweh, Dawid shall never lack a man to sit on the throne of the house of Israel. Yehezekiel 34:23-30. I will set up over them one shepherd, my servant Dawid, and he will feed them. He shall feed them and be their shepherd. And I, Yahweh, will be their Elohim, and my servant David shall be a prince among them. I, Yahweh, have spoken. I will make with them a covenant of peace and banish wild animals from the land, so that they may live in peace and sleep in the woods securely. I will make them and the region, Asikah, and the region around my hill a blessing. And I will send down showers in their season, and there will be showers of blessing. The trees of the field shall yield their fruit. The earth shall yield its increase. They shall be secure on their soil. And they shall know that I am Yahweh when I break the bonds of their yoke and save them from the hands of those who enslave them. They shall no more be plundered for the nations, nor shall the animals of the land devour them. They shall live in safety, and no one shall make them afraid. It will provide for them a splendid vegetation, so that they shall no more be consumed with hunger in the land, and no longer suffer the insults of the nations. Then they shall know that I, Yahweh, or Yahuwah, their El, am with them, and they, the house of Israel, are my people, says Yahweh, Elohim. And finally, Yehezekiel 37:24-28. My servant Dawid shall be king over them, and they shall have one shepherd. They shall follow my ordinances and keep my decrees and fulfill them, and shall live in the land that I gave to my servant Yaakov, in which your ancestors lived. They and their children and their children's children shall live there forever, and my servant Dawid will be their prince forever, and I will make a covenant of peace with them. It shall be an everlasting covenant with them, and I will bless them and multiply them, and I will set my sanctuary among them forever, evermore. My dwelling place shall be with them. I will be their Elohim, and they shall be my people. Then the nations of the world will know that I, Yahweh, sanctify Israel with my sanctuary, when my sanctuary is among them forevermore. These are all set B. And it's not everything. It's not all the scriptures. You can go back to when the Most High made the prophecy with Dawid and through his loins, we know Shlomo, and through Shlomo, eventually we know that these scriptures, amongst with others, are telling you what the Messiah will be like during this time period. Everybody following me? It's exhaustive. Meaning, as you go through these scriptures, it doesn't change. It's clear and consistent. It's a consistency. And it's empirically verifiable, meaning we know. These are what we know. Everybody following? Anybody confused? I'm wrapping it up. Sometimes you got to be patient to get all the, All right. So, what happens when you know what you're looking for? You know what you're looking for. And then you have a dissonance. Meaning, you know what you're looking for. I thought I was looking for Yazakar. Or let's go back to Malachi Yul. He's the one. He was going to deliver us from America and so on and so forth. They put him under the chair. So what happens? It's a dissonance. Distance, meaning we go here now, We broke away from what we know and go to what we believe. All right? So, Bereshit, chapter 3. And again, I'm just going to give you three scriptures, and I'm sure many more you can go to. I'm not saying this is the end all be all. It's more scriptures. But, and Yahweh said to the serpent, because you did this, you are cursed above all cattle, above every beast of the field. Upon your belly you will go, and the dust you shall eat in the days of your life. And I will put enmity between you and the woman, because between your seed and her seed, and they shall bruise your heel. I don't know. You all can tell me what that means in relation to what this belief is. Because you do it all the time. You tell me all the time. I've probably said it before. Alright? To heal them. 118 and 22. The stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. Exodus 12 and 46. And it shall be eaten in the house. You shall not take any of the animal's bones outside the house, and you shall not break any of its bones. See, that's Mashiach right there. You following me? It's become proof texting. Because you already believe something, because again, you were given New Testament concepts or principles or whatever before you knew your culture. So now you're trying to get to your culture and you're looking back. Oh man, you see that everywhere. You can see said see everywhere. But is it in context? Is it exhaustive? Is that text that you're pulling out clear and consistent? And don't get me wrong, I'm not sitting here saying, give me one, was it? Yeshayah chapter 53. I'm not saying I know what it means. I can tell you what I understand, but then when it shifts, I need to know my Hebrew, because that's how heavy that one is. So when you get to certain scriptures, you got to know what you're going to articulate, what you're going to fight, what you're going to be like, listen, I can say, I don't know. I don't have it all. And we always say, we don't have it all, but what we know, and what we give you is what we give you. And you could research it as well. You could look it up yourself. Nothing that Chizakyah has been studying, you can't study. I'm just in a position to share it with you. I'm your op. But again, exhaustive, clear, and consistent. Y'all was clear and consistent, right? You sure? Empirically verifiable, meaning he puts you in a position, not always, but when it's important for you, you know what you got to do. You know what you got to do. And again, we could rationalize, well, the people in the wilderness, they knew some stuff, and they didn't do it, they died. Right. They died. I see your hand, sis. Wait, say it again? I didn't hear the first part. Shot.
We have some things on the shot level.
Okay.
So, could they just magically see it on different levels?
I could I can say, let me see, what we always say? Midrash, right? For the most part, when you say Peshat, what's Peshat? What does that mean?
Literal.
Okay. What it says, right?
Right. We'll right. Read. Yeah.
Can you read that and go straight to push it? Not push out. I just said it. Suit.
I'm just trying to understand why they're saying it.
Why who's saying it?
Secret.
Right. The thing is that you got Sud, excuse me, Peshat, Ramez, or Darash, and Sud. Right? Four levels of interpretation. Which one of these can you prove? Which one of those four can you prove with this? Right. Right. So what happens is, let's just say hypothetically, you're the Christian, right? And you're coming to me with your belief. And I'm coming to you the Torah says this. I'm going to scriptures. And that's done away with. You just gotta believe. What is that? When I say that, what does that do to you? If you're telling me something that I could read, you could show me, exhaustive, clear, consistent, empirically verifiable, meaning you know. And I say, well, I hear all what you're saying, but you gotta believe. What does that do to me? For you.
But who are you at this time?
I'm somebody that's bringing you scriptures.
Christian or?
I'm saying you represent the Christian. And then I'm showing you something, and you say, well, you just gotta believe. What are you doing when you do that?
I guess I'm just trying to tell you, forget about what you're thinking about in your head and just have faith on what I'm telling you.
Exactly, but what does that do? It's dismissive.
Right.
It's dismissive.
And kind of, in a way, it should be protected.
Well, they'll probably hit you with a couple of those.
Right.
But what I'm saying is, when people go to the realm from you're showing them for shot, which is basic. And they go straight to another realm like, oh, we that. That's cognitive dissonance. It happening before your eyes. You've seen it. It's happened. You probably did it. Because you start going into these realms that ain't got nothing to do with this. It has nothing to do with what the Torah is saying. But it's hard for me to stand here and tell you that because in your mind, yeah, it does. Look, if I go right here, it's saying what Mashiach is and what has happened. We, because we never knew, we have created a new concept of Mashiach. We created a new concept of Mashiach that came along with Gentiles taking our culture. Everybody understand? You don't have to believe me. You have to trust me. I would like you to trust me. But all I'm doing is bringing you the information. And again, I have not exhausted all the set A's, all the set B's, and all the set C's. These are just examples. I'm sure you could come up with 50 of each or whatever. I don't know if you can come up with 50 from here. You might come up with less than maybe less than 10, I don't know. But if, you know, Abraham walked with the three men, that's your sure right there. If you count that, maybe you can come up with 10. But everybody understand cognitive dissonance? Anybody still have a question about that? And now you could bring back what you believe. You could bring it back to your mind, what you believe. I just gave you what you know, but you could bring back what you believe. Cognitive dissonance, circular reasoning, what's the other one? Say again? Proof texting and set theory. And it will behoove you if you can get, start looking at the scriptures and putting them in this context, what we know versus what we believe. You know, Adonin did a song, what we see and what we believe in what we see. How you say it? Right. There you go. Got us all confused. And it's because we all, pointing all my fingers at myself first, came into the culture already believing that I knew something. Yes, sir.
Is there any way you can have this on an attachment?
A PowerPoint?
Whichever.
Well, type it up and send it out. I had a book. I wrote a lot of stuff, a lot of notes, and so on. I can take
the
time.
The dates.
Yeah, you go to Wikipedia and find the dates.
Okay.
But I found the dates before that, and then I happened to be looking at it, and I threw out the dates that I had. Because some of it is based on Christian thought. So they're going to date stuff earlier than what they really say. So then you can. I'm not just taking this and running with it. You look at the references of where they came from. And people say, you know, well, you go to Wikipedia, anybody can type stuff in. I tried to type stuff in. It didn't work for me, but maybe you got it better off. But it has references. All you have to do is to see if it's legit, is go to the references and see if it's legit. Yes. Because that's my belief, right? So the only proof I have of him is what's written in the New Testament and based self-evidence of what's happened. Now, when you deal with Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, right? It's gonna always, what's gonna play with your cognition and your dissonance is you already know, you have been here for a time to where you realize you have a culture, right? So whether, how can I put it? When you study it, you know, some people say it's an amalgamation of men, because y'all didn't know, there's a bunch of people during that time period that got crucified that came and said they were king of the Jews, or they were the king, so on and so forth, and they died. So it was many would-be saviors that were sacrificed or crucified on the cross. What I see, even in Talmudic studies and certain studies that date back there, the Jews believe he existed. You understand? Certain writings say it was a person of that. But what I break away from based on what I know versus what I believe is Moreh Yeshua, Rabbi Yeshua. Because during that time, it was many movements of teachers. So the question is, say, like, it's just kind of like, why would he, besides the belief aspect added to him, why would he say, and this is a question, nobody really could give me a right answer, you know what you believe, but why would he say, until heaven and earth passes away, not one jot, one tittle, should no wise pass from the law? Why would he say that? Say it again? He got it from Torah. I don't think any of us in this room would say anything different than what he said, okay, pertaining to Torah. Okay. So it's kind of moot when we say, well, Yeshua said, I mean, any Yah-fearing Hebrew would say the same thing. You follow me? I'm giving you things that are that's factual versus what you want to believe or what you come to believe. What he's saying, or the things that he's saying, if you're listening to it, is no different than 100 years from now, they got a book about Baruch. And he said, listen, he's giving you how he sees Torah from a down-to-earth way in 2016. And 200 years from now, they may mandate put it with a book and say, listen, this dude was the truth. He was it. I don't know what dogmas or what his family may spread about him. Yo, my daddy used to walk on water in the tub. I don't know. You know, I see my daddy one time hover off the roof of the house. I don't know. It's up to the person reading to say, with all these things put in there, if it's true or if it's not true, that's on you. But according to this, I don't have to believe that. According to the book, you don't have to believe that. I'm not telling you not to believe what you believe. That's not what I'm saying. I'm just giving you facts. Because a fact is, it doesn't say you need to believe in a virgin birth to be saved. Isn't that strange? So much effort to put that there, but it doesn't say you have to believe that. And it says, you know, in brackets. Everybody knows what brackets mean. Somebody put that there. Supposed father of Jesus or Yeshua. So when I'm reading it, or when somebody's expounding on things, these are what I'm thinking about. But I understand if you don't know these things, you're not thinking about it. Because you're just going with what you know, what you come to know, and what you believe. Somebody could explain it away, but if Joseph wasn't the father of Yeshua, why even give me his lineage? Why? What's the point? Is that a thought? Is that a consideration? Well, he adopted him? Is that how it works? Is that that's what we see in Torah? You could adopt, and now they become, you know, we see, you know, I mean, does it? I don't know. Tell me. I mean, I know, but I'm trying to see if y'all know, because you should give me an answer.
Do you want an answer?
Sure.
Oh, okay.
All
right. You can answer. Well,
I say about Mary.
Also have seed. And it says from the seed of God. So she is both of them their seed. So and also
that feeling right there, that feeling that you're feeling right there. That
no, it's not. This.
What make it make sense to me?
It's a making sure that I say that I read and did a little stuff on. Joseph being from Delvin's lineage.
Talking about the king. The lineage of the king. Okay.
Right there. Wasn't one of his sons cut off for being on the throne? Okay. And wasn't that the progenitor of Joseph?
I have to look at the lineage. You're talking about just right there. Yep. The one that said not one of his seeds shall
Yakanai.
Okay.
Yeah, that was, I believe that was a part of
it. So you're saying because of that, that's why it had to be the Ruach hovering over her and so on and so forth.
You
asked
a question, I'm just answering that part.
I guess maybe I'm helping you because you know we've all heard. Well, I'm trying. That's what you're saying, right?
I'm saying that. Yeah.
Okay. All right. So that's exhaustive.
No.
That's clear and consistent.
No.
That's empirically verifiable.
No.
So you don't know. You believe that. Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. That's it. You made my point. Anybody else? What doesn't matter? Everything matters. So go ahead. What doesn't matter?
Sit back.
When it comes to those three, I believe that you said that those three are the things that are important for your salvation, right?
When it comes to not. I say this, things that are important for your salvation, it's repeated.
Okay.
More than three times, so, more than four times, more than five times, it's repeated.
So going back to Adonis' equation,
mm-hmm.
A squared plus B squared equals C squared, mm-hmm. You're responsible, the book was written to us, right?
Right.
So we are only responsible for the things that we have to do.
Right.
So it is important what Yah does, because he didn't ask, no, where were you when I laid the foundations of the earth? He didn't give an answer on how he laid the foundations or how these things were created.
Mm-hmm.
It's just, we just know that he was created.
Mm-hmm.
But the things that we do need to know is
mm-hmm.
that we need to follow these laws, statutes, and commandments
right.
in order for us to get salvation on our behalf.
Right.
Now, whatever Yah does is what Yah does.
Right.
So it wouldn't have to be repeated, or his name wouldn't have to be given, or any of that wouldn't have to occur.
Wait, stop right there. I'm trying to see. My internal alarm just went off. You said one thing, and then you said it. What do you mean it doesn't matter if it has to be repeated?
What I'm saying
the things that are repeated are for you.
Okay.
Right. So you're saying the things of Yah that's for him doesn't have to be repeated.
He didn't repeat it because it's not for us to know.
It's not for us to know.
It's a bunch of things that he has done in terms of creation, how we were created, the powers and all that are not mentioned.
Mm-hmm.
But they're not exhaustive in the scriptures, but they are mentioned.
Dimension. Okay.
So, but the things that are exhaustive
pertain to your salvation.
Okay.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
That's all I'm saying. So I'm saying set C is not exhaustive, clear, consistent, empirically verifiable because
but,
he already gave us the blueprint.
I guess how can I put this? How can I put this? Dang, I don't even want to go there. But because I was trying to wrap it up. But the thing is that when you're dealing with salvation, it's consistent. It's consistent. And it was, it was always physical. Always. And if you, you know, if you find something and you want to hit me up the head with it or whatever, like, ah, right here, you know, I'm good with that. But I think I can stand on salvation is always physical. Anytime you see Israel being saved, it was physical. Not taken away from the spiritual at all, but it's consistent. So I don't have to go here. I don't. But I could choose to go here, and anybody could choose to go here. But I'm giving you what's factual. The facts is salvation is consistent. And you still have to do set A, and you don't know until, you know, Yah does B in the conclusion, wherever you end up. But it's still exhaustive, it's still clean, consistent, it's still empirical, verifiable. You do know what you need to do. And you do know what Yah will do in the end result of what you do. When I say you know, I mean, you know you're going to be judged according to your actions. That's it. Any other thoughts? Everybody just kind of looking at me like. And it's okay. It's okay. Nobody else? No thoughts? Or you got to go home and deal with your, you know, and making it make sense and, you know, come back for me next week with a whole book of what you wrote down. I'm like, ah, I got you. I got something for you. Anybody? Moreh's.
They got the food on the table.
Oh, the food's on the table. But
so you don't really read the New Testament?
I read it. Because, I mean, when I say I read it,